Good evening, everyone. I think we'll wait for another 1 minute, 1 or 2 minutes, then we'll start the session today. I see a lot of old faces here, and few are also new ones. Some of them are also parts of students or participants of our old crocodile counts. So it's good to see you, some known faces, and I welcome all of you. Today's session is focused on monitoring crocodiles. Those who have attended yesterday's session by Dr. Raju Vyas, which was focused more on the ecological aspect, the biological aspect, and the evolutionary aspect, other all other aspects of crocodilians. But today especially we'll focus on how to monitor a crocodile species, and especially species found in India, right? So I am Anirudh Vasava. For those who don't know, I am the research coordinator at VNC, that's Voluntary Nature Conservancy. So I have been involved in research and conservation for last decade now, and I have been working with different species like Indian wolf, crocodilians, Indian wild ass. I have been working on even birds also, very endangered bird, critically endangered bird, that is the forest owlet. So, and our projects are spread across Gujarat, in Kutch, in South Gujarat, in Central Gujarat, in different parts of Gujarat. So we have been working with very long now in Gujarat. And we started our crocodile project in 2013. Okay, we focused our research in Central Gujarat in the districts of Kheda and Anand, actually, sorry. Anand and Kheda. So it's a twin districts which are in the center. And certain parts of both districts is known as Charotar. So we have focused our work in this Charotar region. It is a beautiful landscape. It's an agricultural landscape dominated by agriculturals and villages. And a very peculiar habit, characteristic of this landscape is that all the villages have wetlands. Some of them have one wetland, one pond. Some of them have like 11, 12. Some of them have 15 wetlands, small and bigger. So it's a very unique landscape, you know, and all these ponds are occupied by crocodilians. We really don't have data on how this crocodile came here, but when we talk with the older people who have been living in this village, they say that they were stalked by the Gaikwads, the royalties of Vadodara state, Baroda state. So they used to restock crocodiles here. People say that for hunting purpose, but we have seen that there have been a historical distribution of crocodiles both in Mahi River and another river is Watrak River. So Charotar lies in these two areas, Charotar lies Watrak and Mahisagar River. Okay, so both of these rivers had historical distribution. So we also speculate that some of the population have also dispersed naturally from both of these riverine ecosystems. We have been conducting research on nesting ecology, their population, habitat, using different methods. So I'll be putting a lot of content from my research conducted here. So let me share my presentation. So monitoring crocodiles, tools and techniques. So first question is, see, basically if we would have been made this presentation physically possible, then it would have been quite interesting, you know, to interact with people and, you know, ask questions, make more interactive, but it's not possible in this, you know, era of webinars, but we'll try to, indulge as much as possible. So let me ask you a question. I don't need answers from you. Just think over it. Okay. Why do we need monitoring? Why do we need to monitor any population? Leave crocodile, any wildlife population, whether it is birds or any insects or mammals, anything. Why do we need to monitor those populations, right? So this is very basic question. If you want to conduct a survey, if you want to start a research, the first question is, why do you want to do it? Okay, so there may be different reasons for conducting a research program, starting a monitoring program. Okay, let's see a few of them. So one of them is biological interest, ecological interest. Okay, especially bird migrations. Okay, a bird migrates from one continent to another continent, one country to another country. Okay, if we monitor those populations, we can understand that how the bird migration occurs, at to what extent the bird migration is occurring. Okay, likewise, animal dispersal. Okay, if you have take an example of tigers, because I worked on tigers. Okay, so a tiger moves from one habitat to different habitat. There are records that a tiger have been moving from one tiger reserve to different other tiger reserve. They are traveling more, like they have traveled more than 300 kilometers to reach another area. So, okay, so only when we monitor such areas, such population, we come to know that the animal has been dispersing in this area, right? Game management is more of a concept of a European and American type, actually, you know, where they use some of the animals for game hunting. They kill those animals for game. And of course, it is legalized in those countries. Okay, so for that purpose also, sometimes what happens is, like, an animal is considered a pest. It is creating a lot of damage to the humans and the property that human has, right? So the best examples are rodents. Okay, if you have a granary, the rodents are there, they will damage your grains, right? There are birds. If you look at parakeets, in Vidyanagar, we have thousands of parakeets which go around the area, okay? And they feed on the different crops around here, which grown around here. So in some of the parts, they are so aggressively attacking some of the crops that they are almost a pest. Okay, the farmers are really fed up of these parakeets. So likewise, other birds are also there. Herbivores, take an example of Nilgai. Okay, we have been protecting Nilgais for very long. It has a very cultural relevance in Indian scenario. Okay, but its population is increased a lot. And in some of the area, they create such a havoc that poor farmer cannot tolerate such loss. Okay, so monitoring also is required for such pest species to monitor their status, right? Some of the species are endangered and threatened. Okay, some of the species are also introduced in some area. Okay, so to understand the progress of recovery of those species, those population, we need monitoring. Okay, and overall, globally, we also need to understand how many species are there in a particular habitat, in a particular area, to understand the ecological richness, biological diversity of that area. And also to understand, like, what are the reasons and what is the causes of humans on these species, on these wildlife species population. To understand that also, we need monitoring. But if you summarize all these objectives, these reasons, ultimately it comes to that, to establish the conservation status of any species and to help improve their management decision. Only when we monitor any population, we'll have a certain data of those population, the numbers, okay, the density, okay. So based on that numbers only, we'll have understanding what to improve and what to decrease, okay? What decisions to make, what management steps to take. So all this depends on monitoring process. So monitoring is very important. So yeah, monitoring process. So what is a monitoring process? What does it consist of? Okay, let's look at it. So it has basically five phases. It may consist of some sub phases also, but basically it has five phases. Okay, I have just not included raising fund for that, which is one of the most important aspect of a monitoring process. Okay, the first and important is raising fund, but anyways, I have not incorporated here. So first thing is, like, you have to think over why to monitor, what populations to monitor, okay, what methods to use, what people will be involved in such programs, are they trained or not. So if they are not trained, we need to provide them training also. So such things needs to be consideration while in designing a monitoring process. Okay. We also need to standardize methods for monitoring, and then comes actual monitoring process in the field, conducting surveys. Okay, you go in the field. Okay, you deploy your instruments. You go in the field and you collect the data. Then comes to the data management. You come back to your office, your institution, your organization. Okay, you enter the data, you filter the data, you remove the erroneous data. Okay, and when it's done, the fourth step, that is data analysis. Okay, you analyze those data. Okay, you provide some statistical analysis. And nowadays there are very sophisticated and wonderful softwares available. Some of them are free also, which can do a wonderful analysis of such data. Okay, so based on that, you do the data analysis, which will provide you diversity, density, population status, and everything, distribution, everything, including GIS also. So once you have analyzed the data, okay, the most important thing is reporting such data. Okay, you have done everything. You have done everything. You have collected data, you have funds, you have to manage the data properly, you have analyzed wonderfully using the most sophisticated, most recently available statistical analysis. But if people don't know, if the research community doesn't know about what you have done, if the managers doesn't know what you have achieved, then it is useless. Okay, so the most important comes reporting such information. So in the form of a report or a research paper that you publish in any journals, and based from once all these steps are complete, you will get an understanding where we have lagged, okay, where we need to improve upon in this area, where we need to modify our methods, where we need to modify our analyzing techniques. Okay, based on those refining, you again work on the protocols and methods, and you work. So in a way, this circle continues for long, right? So various techniques are used for counting crocodiles, and let me tell you, we'll not be going deeper into those very sophisticated techniques and statistical analysis of such methods, because this session is specially created for people who are not non-scientific background, who are not scientists, okay, non-biological backgrounds. So we'll not be using such deeper understanding of monitoring protocol here. So let's see it. So this various techniques depends on various factors. Okay, one of the first important is habitat type. So where you are going to do a monitor program, okay, what kind of habitat it has, whether it is a coastal area, it's an estuarine area, it's a riverine area, it's a pond area, okay, whatever kind of it is, the method of monitoring will depend on the habitat type. Okay, take an example of mangroves. Some of the mangroves are so deep, okay, you may not be able to go and count those mangrove areas. Okay, in that case, you have to use indirect methods, probably modern modern tools of monitoring like drones and remote sensing and all those. Okay, so what I mean to say is, like, your method of monitoring will depend on habitat type. Okay, cost, money. If you don't have money, okay, you will not be able to use sophisticated and advanced kind of methods to monitor crocodilians. Okay, you just so costing is very important. Okay, if you need, as I said in the earlier slide, that first and most important thing is raising funds for such project. Okay, so if you don't have funds, you cannot use sophisticated methods. So that also depends on that. Then field logistics. Okay, what facilities are available? Whether there is a place to live or not, okay, whether there is a road to travel or not, okay, how you will reach there, how you will stay there, all these factors also matter in choosing a monitoring method. Okay, and ultimately goal of the study. Okay, if you want to just monitor a population for a kind of management purpose, you may not require very sophisticated or very advanced study of monitoring. But if you're looking at scientific findings for such species, okay, you want to understand more ecological aspects, more behavioral aspects of species, then of course you need to use more advanced methods of monitoring, right? So, what is the first thing that one should do while starting a survey? Okay, if a person, layman person who doesn't know anything, okay, about an area, whether there is a species or not, whether there is a crocodile in that area or not, what one should do, you know? So, the first thing that should be done is like a go and do a Reiki survey, do an exploratory survey. Okay, what is Reiki survey? Okay, it's a kind of fun survey. You just go around, you know, see the area, okay, see the habitat, okay, look for the different signs for that animal. That's and one of the important method which is very widely used nowadays is key informants survey. What is that? Okay, sometimes the species is so cryptic, sometimes the species is very shy. It lives in a habitat which is not possible to go in that habitat. But the people who have been living around those area, they at certain point of time they must have seen those species. Okay, so it's better to ask those people living around. Okay, you go and just ask whether you have seen the species or not. When did you see it? Okay, did you see the hatchlings? Did you see the eggs or not? Okay, so such informant surveys are very important to lay the foundation of a more advanced and sophisticated way of monitoring crocodilians. Now, once you know that you asked people that there is a crocodile in that area, what should be done? Okay, you look for indirect signs. What are indirect signs? Okay, see, this is a crocodile burrow. The crocodile, you may not see a crocodile in that area, but you will find a burrow. If there is a breeding population in that area, okay, there is a significant population in that area, you might find burrows in that area which says that there is a crocodile, though you may not see it at that time. Okay, so this is one indirect sign. Then there are marks. Okay, if there is an animal, it will move at certain point of time. Okay, so it will leave certain marks in the edges of the water. Okay, based on that, you also can make that there is, the animal is present here. These are eggshells, crocodile eggshells. Okay, as I said, like you don't have to see an animal to say that there is an animal here, right? These are again eggshells. Such you so you should look for indirect signs. You will definitely find indirect signs if there is a presence of a crocodile in that area, right? Another indirect sign is the scat of crocodilians. Okay. Those chalk-like thing, it's almost you thought the see the third picture, it's almost powder-like. Okay, the digestive system, the digestive juice of a crocodilian is very powerful, very powerful. Okay, it can digest anything. Okay, it's like just chalk-like, it's a material, it's powder material only. Okay, so those who have seen the scat of crocodile, they I think they will understand better. So this is also an indirect sign. So whenever you go to a place and you don't see a crocodile, that doesn't mean that it has no crocodile. You look for indirect signs. You look for burrow. You look for the remaining marks. Okay. You look for the scats. Now let's see some of the direct methods of counting. So the primary method that we use, okay, here in Charotar is day basking count. We conduct a program known as Charotar Crocodile Count every year, and in that program that is which is conducted in winter, the first session of January. So we use this day basking count to count crocodiles because it's a winter, so crocodiles extensively indulge in basking, and that's the time that you can really count. You know, you can have a really good estimate of those crocodiles, and especially of those size of those crocodiles. You know, it's not easy to see crocodiles outside. It's only winter time that you see them outside, and it's you can just estimate the size. But of course, this comes with experience. Not first timer will not have any idea. Like a crocodile is like 100 meter away, 50 meter away, and you cannot make out the size of such animal. It only comes with experience, right? Another method that we use is a night survey, spotlight survey. We also do another program here in Charota, that is a wetland watch, which is conducted in the month of May. Unfortunately, this time we could not do it in 2020 because of the pandemic situation and the lockdown situation. But this is very important method. In summer, what happens is like there is a lot of heat, okay, in the night. So all the most of the crocodile comes up, and they are most of them are in the water, okay. So when you have a spotlight, very strong spotlight, maybe a torch will also work, okay. When you throw a light on the crocodiles, their eyes will glow, okay. So based on the glowing of those lights, you can count the crocodiles. Let me show you some pictures. That is Vishal Mistry, our field coordinator, very good at. Okay, can you see those blinking, the glowy spots? Those are crocodile eyes. Okay, you actually don't see crocodiles, but based on the glowing of the eyes, okay, those eye actually shines, no? So based on that, you can count the crocodiles. Okay, so this is more of an like a flashlight photography. You can see those crocodiles. The eyes are shining. So you can also see that distance between two spots also helps you to, you know, make a size estimate of an animal. Okay, the smaller the size, the smaller the animal will be, right? Now you are using both the direct counting methods, day basking count method, or you are using the night shine spotlight methods. What data you should collect? The first thing you need to collect is like the size of the crocodile. And as I said that it is not easy to make out the size of a crocodile. It only comes with experience. Second thing is the number of individuals. How many individuals are there? Were there only single individual, two individuals, or there were like 10 individuals? In Charotar, in some of the wetlands, we see 25 crocodiles at a time. Place of sighting. Where did you sight it? Was it in the water? Was it on the bank? Okay, was it basking or what? Okay, so place of sighting. Habitat, what kind of habitat it is? It is a riverine, it's a pond, it's a lake, it's a ditch. Okay, so you have to write down the habitat also. Time of sighting, whether you sighted the animal in the morning, in the afternoon, in the night. And activity of the crocodile, what the crocodile was doing, whether it was basking, was chasing other crocodile, was swimming, okay. And presence of juveniles, and whether there were small crocodiles, where there were juveniles with adults, okay. I have written females here, but it's not possible to make out a male and a female, okay. They are not a polymorphic species, okay. They both look the same, so you cannot make out, right. And if there is a presence of juvenile, then how many juveniles were present? This is something basic data. You can add more data if you want. And this is a data sheet that we use here during our population surveys in Charotar in both the programs. Okay. So we classify animals into different sizes, like whether it was more than 3 meters, whether it was between 2 to 3 meters, whether it was 1 to 2 meters, it was less than 1 meter. If you cannot make out the size, just put those animals into unknown size, right? Note down the size always in meters. This makes easier to, you know, kind of estimate a size. Okay, people are not really good with making out sizes of those animals. Okay, whether it is 2 foot or whether it is 3 feet. So people are not good at this. So it's better to put them in like a broader category of 1 meter, 2 meter, and 3 meters. So as I told you. Now, just look, I have made some illustration to give you an idea. So if you are looking crocodiles in a river and ecosystem or a canal, or a, so what kind of method you should, if you have funding, if you have money, then you can use a boat to do that. Okay, using a flashlight. If you don't have enough money, no problem. You can use a different method. If you have a vehicle or a bike or a bicycle, You can use that to drive around, drive on the edges of those area if those riverine or canals have roads. Fortunately, in Charotar, we have very good road networks on both the sides of canals. If you don't have any money, don't worry. You can still do the monitoring program. Just use the Rajdhani Express, okay? Yes, use your legs. In Charotar, we also have different kind of, as I said, like there are a lot of wetlands. So most of our crocodiles survive in these wetlands. Okay. So what we do here is wherever we go to a field, whenever we go to a pond, okay, we try to find out a vantage point from where we can look at the whole pond. Okay. And then we scan the area and count the crocodiles. Actually, you see those A's, actually, those are crocodiles. It was supposed to be crocodiles, but I think it is not supporting that one. So, yeah. So if there is a larger pond and a small team or one person cannot cover a whole area, okay, you make two teams or three teams, divide the area into two or three. You divide the teams into and do the counting, okay? This is a very interesting concept, double observer sampling. Okay, we have been using this concept for very long now, and we are trying to, analyze data based on that. Okay, why we use this? You see this, this A crocodile. Okay, this person can see this crocodile. Okay, but this person may not be able to see this crocodile, whereas this person will be able to see both the crocodiles. Okay. So what we do is like we do the sampling, we do the counting independently, okay, by two observers. And then we collect the data from both the observers, then we analyze those data, right? This is to minimize the observer errors actually. Yeah, same. Now, when to count? What is the best time to indulge in a monitoring program? Okay, as I said, like winter is the best time to do a basking count because during that time you can easily make out the size of the species. Okay. We also supplement those day basking counts with these night counts, eyesight counts. In some of the wetlands, you see there is a lot of vegetation. Okay, you don't really see crocodiles basking because there are not very good basking areas in those areas. So we also count night counts in those areas, those ponds, to supplement the basking counts. And I said summer is a very best time. What happens is like in winter, you don't really get a good estimate of juveniles, small crocodiles. Okay, they are hidden in vegetation. Okay, they don't really come out near large crocodiles. Okay, so they remain away from large crocodiles. So we don't really get a very good representation of juveniles in basking data. But in summer, you see wherever it is, even a small crocodile who is hidden in a vegetation, its eye will shine. Okay, so you really get a very better presentation of the numbers in summer. But in winter, you really get a chance to see the size of those animals, to estimate the size of those animals. Okay. And monsoon, we also do this monitoring program because this is a breeding time. And it's especially important that we look for a nest in those areas. We look for burrows where there are nests. Okay. So that we understand the breeding success of the population. So these are the times that one should do monitoring programs in certain areas in your area. Of course, the monsoon time is also the dangerous one. Okay, so we have to be really very careful because the female is really aggressive, very protective. Okay, it aggressively protects its nest and burrows, even juveniles. So you have to be really careful while doing monitoring program in monsoon. Very important and one of a very kind of advanced method that people use, that scientists use, is radio tagging and marking crocodiles. Earlier, when we didn't have radio tags, we used to do marking. We used to cut some parts of the crocodile, especially on the tailor parts, scutes, in a certain pattern. Okay, and when the animal was captured again, we used to compare the pattern with that animal and compare whether the same animal was captured or not. So based on that, one could, using the capture and recapture method, they can make out the number of population. But nowadays, radio tagging is widely used nowadays, especially if you see this photo. This is a Ghadiyal conservation program which is being conducted in Chambal. It is being implemented by Ghadiyal Conservation Alliance and Madras Crocodile Bank in with the support of the government. Okay, so they have been radio tagging this animal for very long now, and the data is wonderful, amazing data. Where the animal is moving in the daytime, okay, where the different classes of animals are, using the habitat in various seasons is being collected. Nowadays, drones are not just for wedding photography and, all the stuff. Drones are so important in now wildlife research that in the IUCN groups, different IUCN groups, we have this specialized group which is really focused on using drones to monitor wildlife populations. Okay, so we have been using drones in Charotar for at least 3 years now. We have been monitoring population through drones because some of the areas are really inaccessible to the teams. We cannot go there, we cannot see in those areas, so drones are really useful. Let me play a video so that you can have an idea. Sorry. Okay, this was taken by our drone in one of the villages in Charotar. Okay. So this was not possible to go in the water. Okay, the crocodiles were lying around that island, small island. So from one side, we could only see one side of the mound. Okay, but using drones, we could see that there were so many crocodiles on the mound, and we could count the crocodiles with a very more precision. Camera traps, automated cameras, they are wonderful. Okay, these animals are very shy. They just, go away from humans whenever they see them. Okay, so these camera traps, automated camera traps are very useful. Okay, so whenever an animal passes through certain area where we have kept those cameras, it takes videos and as well as photos also. Okay, so based on that photos and videos, we can estimate if you put those data into software, we can, estimate the population also and the density index also. Human-crocodile relations, it's very important to monitor this also. While you are also monitoring populations of these species, you also need to understand the people living around, that how they are interacting with these crocodiles, how their behavior is impacting the crocodile population, whether they want to conserve crocodiles or not. Okay, all this information is also important. So assessing human-crocodile relation is also important, and one must do along with a species monitoring. These are some of the things that one must collect during an interview survey. Knowledge, it's the knowledge of people about crocodiles, how much they know about crocodiles, what they eat, when they nest, where is their burrow. Attitude, so what they think about crocodile, okay, how they see crocodiles. And perception is like what happens if a crocodile attacks a person, how they will react. Okay, so those are included in the perception. So a sociological survey should include these elements. Nesting areas, monitoring nesting areas. This is also very important, to understand whether the population will survive very long, whether the population is breeding population or not, whether there is to understand the success of breeding, one has to really monitor these nesting areas. So this is some of the information that we collect while monitoring a nest. I will not go detail into this slide. Now, citizen science. This is one of very important and very emerging, and that we very extensively use at VNC, citizen science. So let me tell you what is a citizen science first. Citizen science is nothing but people who are not even from scientific background can also contribute to science, wildlife conservation, and wildlife monitoring. Right? So our two programs, Charotar Crocodile Count and Wetland Watch, these are two citizen science-based programs where people, irrespective of their academic background, their education, can participate in crocodile counts and contribute to science and to the conservation of crocodiles. So we have been conducting the program since 2013 now, and more than 500 individuals have participated in these programs. Okay, from we had people who were like 65 of age. We have people who are 18 year old. So age is no matter, education is no matter. You just have to be passionate about wildlife conservation. So very recently we started another program, a Croc Watch. See, it's again a citizen science program with that we started. But in this program, we don't really actually invite people in Charotar. People, we use the help of those people who are spread across India, okay, in different states. So we wanted to take their help in understanding the distribution, the population status of three crocodilian species that are found in India. Okay, over a time we realized that we are lacking information from different parts of country. You know, we have information of different species like ghadial, mugger crocodile, or saltwater crocodile from certain area only. Okay, and that too they have been collected by trained scientist people only. Okay, and most of the data are restricted to protected area. Okay, so there are a lot of gray areas in India from where we don't have any information. Although the species has a distribution in those area, but we don't have any information. Okay, so this is one portal that we developed to collect information to fill those gray areas. Okay, ultimately all this information will be collected, will be analyzed, and will be shared with scientists, policymakers, and managers for further processing. Okay, for improving the policy, improving the management of crocodilian species in India. Right. I think why participate, as I have told you already, that it will provide us the information about three species that are found in India. Okay, and this information will be analyzed and shared with interested parties. Okay, you see this picture. It's a picture of Deva village in Gujarat. Yeah, it's amazing, right? This portal will remain open throughout year. However, we are launching the portal on 8th January, like 2 days from now. So we thought of doing a special 3-day Croc Watch event. You know, people who are interested in participating these 3 days have already registered, and the registration has closed now. And people submitting in these 3 days will get an e-certificate for their efforts. But from 11th January, the portal will open for all. Anybody can register at any time and submit the data. Okay. And people who will submit very important data, genuine data, and substantial data from certain important areas. Okay. Those people will be rewarded at the end of the year with a certain prize, very, very interesting prize, which will be helpful to you in the field, or in your academic studies, or in your ecological interest. We have this, I think I'll just show you. Okay, so how this portal works is like, there is a home page, okay, where you will find basic information of the portal. About us, we'll tell you about the program, about VNC, why we started this program, who manages this program, okay? And the program menu will tell you about the schedule of the program, that I will tell you later. Crocs of India will provide you information about the crocodilian species that are found in India. You can contact us if you have any query or question. And there is a account login, I will tell you about it later. Okay. So we had our first stage. It started yesterday with Dr. Raju Vyas lecture yesterday at 4:30. The lecture will be uploaded on YouTube, and those who have missed can see on YouTube. And again, today's session, which is being conducted right now. We also have guest lectures from very eminent scientists of the world. First guest lecture is by Dr. Marisa Tellez. Okay, she is the founder and executive director of CRC, that's a Crocodile Research Coalition, which is based in Belize. Okay, she has been conducting research for very long now, and she'll be talking about the community science and conservation that she and her team have been doing in Belize, and learn what they have learned from those programs. Another guest, second guest, is Dr. Adam Britton. He's a senior research associate at Charles Darwin University, and he is the founder of Gecko, which works for human crocodile conflict, mitigating human crocodile conflict and reducing those conflict. So he has been he has developed and has been monitoring this portal similar CrocBite, okay, which collects data about crocodile attacks the world over, and those information are used for management of crocodiles. Okay, and January 10th will be an online concluding session, like what we have learned during these 3 days, and what are the outcomes of these 3 days. We'll be talking about that in January 10th. And people who will be collecting or submitting data during 8th, 9th and 10th January, as I said, will get a certificate. And one most very important thing is, like, there is a confusion among the participants that they have to come to Gujarat to participate and do the crocodile counting here. No, absolutely no. This is kind of a virtual program. You have to stay at your own place. You have to just go around your place, your village, wetland nearby you, whether it is a pond, lake, river, canal, okay? And report your sightings from there only. You don't have to come to Gujarat or Charotar, no. Okay, we are not doing that this time. This is a very grave situation, this pandemic. Okay, so we are avoiding gathering people. So you just go to a wetland nearby your village or town or city. Just collect data from those areas and you submit those data. If you don't have crocodiles at that time, if you have a historical data, if you have seen a crocodile in past also, 2005, 2015, you can submit that data also during these 3 days. Okay, so it's not necessary that you have to just go to the field and collect data. No, if you have a historical data, if you have older data, you can submit those data during these 3 days, and we'll provide you a certificate. Okay, and from 11, the portal will be open for everyone to join and submit data. Everyone can do the contribution on this portal. I think let's look at how people will be able to submit data, how one must should, you know, contribute their participation, contribute their reports and records. Let's go to the website first. Okay, I already opened the website. So once you go to the website, you will have this this view. Right, as I think I already told you what is home, what does the home contain, about us, program, about the species, and account details.
Share content, share.
Okay. Just hold on. Let me go. Okay. I think now it's open. I didn't open it earlier. Sorry. So if you can see this, I have opened the web page of the portal CrocWatch. Okay. It contains a lot of information. It contains about the interviews of our earlier guest, Sri Bittu Sehgal and Romulus Whittaker. I think everybody knows them in India. So let's straight go to the account detail. Okay, So those who have already registered, you will have this menu, okay. And after 10th, there will be another option to register also. So let's log in. So once you log in with your credentials, you will receive this kind of page, okay, where you will have if you have submitted previous if you have submitted records previously, then it you can see here, okay. If you haven't submitted submissions and you want to submit new observations, you can submit through this this click, okay. I'll just click the submit new observations. Okay, once you click that, a page will open like this. Okay, so we'll slowly go and see one by one what things needs to be filled while you are collecting data. So first thing is your details, this participation and ID and name will be automatically filled once you register with the portal. Okay, you don't have to do it differently, separately, right? So once you go to a field and you have sighted a crocodile, what things needs to be filled? Location, okay? So there are two options here, inside a protected area and outside a protected area. So if you have been to a protected area, or if you are in the protected area, okay, just click inside a protected area, it will open another menu, okay? It says states here. So you just go to that menu, there is a drop down. You click on any state that you visited or that you belong to. Okay, let me just click Gujarat. Okay, and within a few seconds, you will have an option, another option showing all the protected area of Gujarat, right? Let me take an example of Girnar Wildlife Sanctuary. Okay, and if you have collected data outside protected area, just choose outside protected area, okay, and then you will have another two options. One is the auto fetch my location. Okay, once you click it, the software will automatically fetch your location, whether you are in Delhi, Assam, Tamil Nadu, wherever you are, whatever place you are, it will automatically fetch it. Okay, there you have another option. If there is not a good signal, good GPS, network, okay, you can also do it manually. Okay, if some of your data are historical data and you don't know the location, auto fetch will not work. So that time you can manually enter the data. Here you can write the address, right, like this one, and you can enter the latitude and longitude if you have available those options. If you have those data, sorry. Okay, so inside protected area and outside protected area. Okay, once you have done that, there is more information to fill up. Okay, what species did you sight? Okay, whether it was a mugger crocodile, whether it was a saltwater crocodile, or it was a gharial. Okay, let me choose mugger crocodile. Okay, then type of sighting, what kind of sighting it was, whether you just sighted the animal, whether you sighted a dead animal, if you are a researcher, if you are a naturalist, and if you have put up a trap and you got a crocodile photo, okay, so you that is if you are not specific about that from these options, just choose other, and you will get another tab in which you can enter your data, okay, whether it was like for example, okay, so you can enter anything that you want, okay, but if it was a sighting, dead animal or camera trap, okay, so I'm just using only sighting, okay, then how many numbers did you observe? Okay, whether it was 10, 1, 20, whatever number that you observed. Let me put, I'll enter 10 individuals. On what date did you enter? I think I'll just put one. Okay. And at what time did you cite it? Okay, we have categorized the whole 24 hours into six categories. Okay, 12 a.m. to 4 a.m., 4 a.m. to 8 a.m., 8 a.m. to 12 p.m., 12 p.m. to 4, and likewise. Okay, so during which time of the day if you did you cite crocodile, you just select this data. I'm just selecting 12 p.m. to 4 p.m. Okay, and what kind of habitat it was, whether it was a river, whether it was a pond, lake, if it was an estuarine, sea coast, or other. If you want, if you choose other, there will be another tab to write it down. I'm ch just choosing it pond. Okay, and from here you can upload your photos. If you have a picture, you can upload your pictures here. Okay, once you have uploaded the picture, you have to just agree. Okay, give your consent that VNC will be able to use this information for the conservation of crocodiles through different initiatives, and then you can just submit your data, right? So this is how you can submit your data. I think the internet is slow, but this, I think this is pretty simple and very clear that how to fill up. So this portal, this submission form will open on 8th January. Okay, it will not open before that. Anyways, I think it's not opening. Anyway, let's go back to the presentation. So I think it was pretty simple. Okay. Now precautions, like this is the most important thing that one should keep in mind. One must keep in mind that your life is very important. It's very, very important than research. It's very important than science. It's important than conservation. It's important than data. Okay. So at no time of your monitoring program, you must cost your life against the data. Okay, so you must take precautions that no accidents, no harm comes to you or your team or your resource or your property. Okay, so for that you must keep a safe distance. Okay, at least 25 to 30 feet you must keep the distance between you and the animal, minimum distance. I'm not saying you can keep 50 and 70 also, but minimum, you please don't go beyond this minimum area. Okay, these animals are wild animals. They have been evolved to hunt. They have been evolved to capture anything they can. Okay, so keep a safe distance. Use binoculars or sporting scope so that there is a safe distance between you and the animal. And as I said, don't go or walk near water bodies or canals or river or pond which is occupied by crocodile. Okay, use these binoculars and sporting scope to, you know, kind of see and view and sight and spot the crocodile. So these are some basic precautions that you must take care. Always be equipped. Always wear shoes. You don't know what you'll find in the field. There will be thorns, there will be, you know, shit by humans, there will be mud. Okay, so always keep shoes. If the area is really sensitive, okay, there is a very good population of crocodilians, okay, use a large stick with you. Keep a large stick with you so that in certain time it can be helpful. Okay, sorry, I think I missed last point. Fine, but these are some basic precautions that one should take care while going into the field and doing a monitoring program of crocodiles. Now, I think a lot of queries have come on, like how to identify the species of crocodiles that are found in India, the gadial, the Magra crocodile, and the saltwater crocodile. But let's first see a question that lot of people have been asking, and people have been really confused with that. Sir, do we have a alligators in India? Okay, what is the difference between alligator and crocodiles? Where we can find the alligators? Guys, we don't have alligators in India. Okay, we have three species, the gharial, the saltwater crocodile, and the mugger. Okay, but let's see, to just clear your confusion. Okay, let's see this slide. Okay, so first difference is in the jaw pattern. Okay, if you look at the side view, okay, the jaw of a alligator, this one is Mississippi or American alligator. You see the lower jaw of an alligator, it is smaller than the upper one. Okay, so you don't see the teeth of the lower jaw, you only see the teeth of upper jaw. Okay, whereas in crocodiles, you can see the teeth of both the jaw, upper and lower, both the jaws. Okay, in this picture, you can see it. Okay, so this is a major difference. When you look at the species from top, okay, the jaw of an alligator is a much more oval shaped, a rounded shaped kind of jaw, whereas the jaw of a crocodile is more of a pointed kind of jaw. So these are some basic difference. There are some difference in the scute patterns also, but this is a basic difference that based on which you can see that this is an alligator or crocodile. But as I said, that it will not be required in India because we don't have alligators, right? The first species is gharial. There has been a Raju Bhai talked about a lot about species identification yesterday, and yesterday's session will be uploaded on VNC's YouTube channel very soon. So those who have missed it can watch that lecture. But let's see the picture. You can see there are two animals here. This one is a male. And some of you will say that, how can you say that it is a male? Okay, you said that you cannot identify males and female in crocodiles, but in gharials, it's an exception because the males have ghada, a pot-like structure on its end of the jaw, upper jaw. Okay, and because of which then also the name comes gharial. Okay, so this ghada is in protuberance on the upper jaw. When a male matures, it will acquire a ghada, whereas female doesn't acquire a ghada. Okay, so this is a difference. And it is pretty easy to identify a gharial in the field, okay, because of its narrow and long jaw. This is mugger crocodile, you can see. Mugger crocodile has a wider jaw compared to the saltwater crocodile that we'll see in the next slide. There are some of the areas in which the gharials and the muggers exist, you know, in a same habitat, in a same, area. Okay, some of the areas of most of the areas of Chambal and some riverine areas of Ganga, parts of Nepal. Okay, these muggers and gharial exist together. Okay, this picture has been taken by Bruce in Katenia Ghat. So this one is gharial and this one is mugger crocodile. Okay, you can see that it has its jaw is very broad. Okay, so these are the pictures of mugger crocodile, and this one is a saltwater crocodile. So you can see that the jaw of a saltwater crocodile is a bit narrower than a mugger crocodile. And guys, it's not easy to, since you will be doing a survey from very far area, it will not be easy to, distinguish in those area where these species exist together, like in Bitarkanika. Okay, these species exist together. So in such area, it becomes difficult, but with experience, you can easily make out whether it is a mugger crocodile or whether it is a saltwater crocodile. So I think since I have told you about like the monitoring methods and differences of the species, okay, and let's see how good your eyes are. So we'll play some fun games. I know I said that if you'd it would have been physically possible, it could have been more interactive. But anyway, I'll show you a picture, and you just have to find out the crocodile in that picture. Okay. And if you correctly, and I'll show you where the crocodile is in later slides. So if you see the crocodile correctly, okay, just pat on your shoulder, okay. अपने आप को शबाशी दे देना, ठीक है, मैं नहीं दे पाऊंगा. सो आई विल गिव यू 10 सेकंड्स टू स्पॉट क्रोकोडाइल्स इन दिस स्लाइड. कैन यू मेक आउट क्रोकोडाइल इन दिस स्लाइड? इट विल नॉट बी ऑलवेज बी ओपन एरियाज इन योर एरिया, इन योर टाउन और इन योर विलेज. देयर विल बी हैबिटेट शो बूसी, शो कवर्ड विथ वेजिटेशन दैट यू विल नॉट बी एबल टू सी क्रोकोडाइल. सो दिस इज अ ट्रेनिंग फॉर योर आईज. कैन यू स्पॉट अ क्रोकोडाइल? If you have spotted a crocodile in the picture, very good, good, well done. Let me show you where the crocodile is. Here is the crocodile. Okay, can you see now? Yes. I'll just zoom it. Okay, this is the crocodile. So it will not be always a, you know, good sightings. You have to work really hard to spot a crocodile in some of the areas. Okay, so this is the crocodile. Yeah, this is a zoomed version. Let's see another one. It's easier one. This is much easier, much, much easier. I think everybody can make out a crocodile. Okay, if you have already spotted the crocodile, well done. Otherwise, this is the crocodile. Okay, this is a zoomed version. Yeah, this is a bit difficult. Can you spot a crocodile in this one? This is muddy waters. This is a bit harder. 5 seconds more, I think. Yeah, it's not that easy, right? This is just to give you an idea like how difficult to spot a crocodile is in the field. We see that we'll just go there and we'll see a crocodile and we'll just, you know, count the, we'll just report the crocodile. It will not be that easy. Okay, you need to train your eyes. You have to go frequently so that your eyes get trained to find crocodile. Your eyes get trained to spot crocodiles in different habitats. Okay, so here is the crocodile. Okay, let me zoom it. This one. Can you see it now? Okay, so I think I have covered basic tools and techniques of monitoring crocodiles. And as I said in the initial phase of the lecture, that this is for non-scientific background people who really want to contribute to science but don't know what to do and how to do it. Okay, so this presentation was for them. Please contribute to the CrocWatch portal. It's a very, very important portal, very nice initiative. Okay, this, your contributions are going to really, impact their conservation. Okay, to the scientists and people who are involved in managing this species. Okay, so please contribute this portal. The portal for general people will open on 11th. And those who have already registered for the special three-day data submission, the portal will open on 8th January. Okay, the website, I think everybody knows the website now, cw.vncindia.org. The link will be also shared in the chat. If you have any question, then I will take some question. Right? These are our people who have really helped us. Ruffer Foundation, Idea Wild, Dilip Mathai Nature Conservation Trust, they have really funded the project and brought it to a different level. NAJA.in has been an organization which works in Ahmedabad and has been involved in crocodile conservation, has been a very long-term collaborator with us, and we have been doing a lot of work together. Forest Department has been our supporter, has been supporting us in different initiatives that we have been doing here. Villagers of Charotar, volunteers of VNC, participants of different events. I thank you, all of them. So I think I'll have some questions now. You can raise your hand. Rupesh.
Hi.
Yeah, nice to see you again.
Oh, thank you. My question is very simple today.
Yes,
that
because,
is how someone...
I'm not able to hear a voice.
Are you audible now?
You need to unmute yourself.
I've already unmuted. Am I audible right now?
Sorry, Rupesh, I couldn't hear you. Can you repeat your?
Are you hearing me?
Yeah, yeah. I think now I'm able to hear you.
So my question is, how someone who is very much interested in crocodile can be a member of your club? That is VNC.
Where are you staying, Rupesh?
I am staying in Gandhinagar.
Okay, Gandhinagar. So yes. Anybody who is interested in working with us can become a volunteer and a member of our organization. The fee is just 200 rupees per year. Okay, you pay that fee, you become a member of VNC. Okay, and you regularly get updates about the events and program that we conduct here in Charothar. Okay. Not only Charothar, we have, like, as I said, programs throughout Gujarat. Okay, we work on Indian wolf, forest owlets in Dang, Indian wildlife in Kutch. So all those programs, information about those programs will be available to the members. We also keep uploading those information on our websites, Facebook, Instagram, Twitters. So you can follow those social media, our social medias, and you will be updated about events. And if you find, and if you feel that I want to actively participate in this program, you just let us know that I want to become a volunteer for this program. I want to contribute this program, and we'll put up your name in for that program, particularly that program, and we'll share other details for that program, right? So in that way, you can also submit the form online also. Okay, so once we have your email and mobile number, we have this WhatsApp group, all the members, a closed group of members. Okay, so you will quickly you will get the information about anything that is happening at VNC.
How can I give my WhatsApp number to you? Because here I didn't find any chat box or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you didn't get chat box.
So I can give you my number, the WhatsApp number. So can you put me add on this that closed group?
Yeah, sure. I'll just give me a number. I can just.
It's
75. Yeah, just hold on. But Rupesh, to be added to that group, you need to become a member for VNC.
So how can I get the membership form?
Yeah, just give me a number.
My number is 7575.
7575.
07.
07.
9816.
9816.
Again,
okay.
I'm repeating
7575-07-9816. Okay, sure. But anyways, you can visit our website, vncindia.org.
I have already visited your website, and I just want to let you know that last year, means 2019, I have gone to Italy, Deva, and Malta every weekends. And I'm taking lots of photographs, lots of drone shots for my interest, because I love crocodile. And I have contacted the VNC club also. I have given numerous mails, SMS call and phone calls, but I couldn't able to get in touch. This is the first time I have seen the active, this kind of webinar actually. So please, please allow me to become the member of this club. And I'm really, I'm an environmental engineer working in an organization called IFCO, and I'm posted in Gandhinagar.
Okay, great. So maybe if you're coming in this area, just give us a call. Okay,
and I don't know any member's name and number, frankly. So if you add me to this group and the WhatsApp group especially, then I am able to call the admin and who actually, please.
Definitely. Okay, since I have your number, I'll just I'll share you my number, my personal number, so that you can contact me anytime you want, right?
Please. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Rupesh. Any other member who want to ask any question? If not, I think we can end the session here, right? Thank you everyone for joining the session. I think it was helpful. Yeah. Okay. Somebody has raised question. Rashmi. Yes, Rashmi. Can you hear me?
Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Talk. Sir, the point where you mentioned about the night mode where we can find out the crocodiles by focusing on their eyes. Mm-hmm. So my question is, all animals' eyes secret something so that they source the light, which reflect lights. If in that crocodile group, a wolf or a fox or any animals just get trapped by the crocodile or just live inside that and count that eyes, then it will be counted on the crocodile list. So means how can we know the exact number? There will be maybe a mistake. And
thank you for the question. See, Rashmi, what happens is, like, you know, all the animals, especially crocodile's eyes, reflect in a different way than other animals, especially mammals. Okay. If you know, there is a substance called as tapetum lucidum, okay, because of which,
yes, sir,
the eyes of the crocodile, yes, glows, right?
Glows.
Yeah, yes. Practically, if you look at the question that you asked, like if a crocodile has caught a dog or a wild pig and if it is still in the water, we might, you know, if an amateur can do the mistake of counting that thing as a crocodile, but not an experienced one, actually, you know. But of course, it can be a double counting of a crocodile, actually, you know. There is no crocodile, but there is different animal, and it can be considered a crocodile during a night count. It's possible, right? Yeah.
Yes, sir. As I am a beginner, so I thought of this question come to my mind. So I
No. Great question, actually. You know, what happens is, like, if you look at those areas, if you look at Charotar in this area, no? So the crocodiles basically majorly live on those fishes. Okay, they don't really depend on mammals for food. Okay, there are abundant fishes in the rivers and ponds and everywhere where the crocodiles are. Okay, so there are very few chances that you will find that such incident of other species, other animal and crocodile on the same time, you know, together in the night. Okay, it can happen. It's not that it's impossible, but it's very rarely. So yeah, that's how it works.
Sir, okay, sir. Thank you. So, sir, next question is the night mode. So is there any particular specific time for them to watch or count the crocodile? Because crocodile also sleep at a particular time. If they sleep, they have to close their eyes. So how can we count? Because we are focusing on them.
The crocodile's sleep is a very different sleep, you know. They are highly evolved species. They don't sleep like humans or even other mammals. If you know that even mammals like elephants and like horses, you know, they sleep half. You know that?
Yes.
They can sleep while even they are standing.
Stand. Yes.
Right? Okay, so crocodile has this more advanced way than this, actually, you know. So they have this amazing mechanism of kind of sleeping certain part of the body and certain part of the body is awake. Okay, so the crocodile actually never sleeps. It just gives rest to its body and parts, actually. Okay,
so sir, what, half part means half part is under the water and half visible to us?
No, that doesn't happen. It has to come out of water to breathe. Okay, it cannot just stay underwater throughout the day. Okay, a crocodile can maximum live under water for 45 minutes there are records of more time also, but on average, they have to come out every 40-50 minutes to breathe. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, and in summer, what happens, especially if you are doing a night counting or this flashlight counting, what happens is that this especially is more favorable in, as I said, in summer. Okay, when during the day it's very hot, so the animal stays in the water. Okay, it comes on the water, it goes inside the water, sometimes takes on the bank, okay, but spends most of the time in the water. So in the night, when the temperature drops drastically, okay, it comes outside. Drastically changes. So in the night, it comes outside the water, okay. So that time, almost all animals are either on the surface of the water or are on the around the pond or a lake. Okay, so that time almost all individuals can be counted in the pond. So they will start coming outside at 7:30 p.m., 8:30, 10:30, and up to 9:30 or 10:30. I think most of the animal will come out of the pond. So that is a time that you can do a counting after 10:30, right?
So after 10:30, they come out to the surface. Yeah,
most of the animal will come out of the water or on the surface.
Most of means you include only crocodiles or other animal species?
Only crocodiles.
Oh.
Just we are talking about crocodiles. So crocodiles, yeah.
So after 10:30, we can observe clearly.
Yeah, it depends on the temperature also, no? It depends on the temperature. As the temperature changes, their timing of coming out of water and going inside water also changes. Okay, so you have to monitor the temperature and season also, at what time you are doing it. Okay, yeah.
According to the season, it varies.
Yeah, this crocodile is a ectothermic species. It has to do everything by depending on outer temperature. Right, so it depends on temperature. If there is, it's a very warm, okay, so its time is different. It's less warm, its time is different. In winter, its time is different. So you have to kind of frequently go to the area to, you know, kind of monitor their behavior of coming out of water.
Okay sir, next question. Rasmi,
you are asking a lot of questions.
Sir, the half part is means present while sleeping and other past is remain stable. So their eyes are opened or closed during sleeping.
So crocodile has this very advanced way of, you know, kind of, it has a different layer which covers its eyes while the crocodile is inside water.
A layer of eyes.
Yes, layer, not exactly layer of eye. There is a different layer which covers its eyelids when the crocodile is inside water. Okay, so the crocodile doesn't close its eyes every time. It can close, it can open also. Okay, but it doesn't have to be closed every time. As I said, it doesn't sleep like humans, you know, by closing both the eyes, you know. It will remain awake at any point of time. Right.
Its
metabolism, its behavior is much more advanced than any other mammal or even humans. You know, they have been surviving since the times of Jurassic. Okay, all other species got wiped out through ice ages and comets that struck on the earth, but crocodiles have survived till now. It means their ways of surviving is much more advanced than any other species. Okay. There is a lot of information available on net if you want to read those information, right?
Okay, thank you, sir. Yes, sir. A student can be a membership of this crocodile.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
Sir, a student, because I am a student, I want to do something means in your crocodile survey or anything, or want to a membership. So how can I do that?
Where are you staying right now?
Sir, I am from Odisha.
Orissa. So Rashmi, we have these two programs that we conduct here. One of them is Sarotar Crocodile Count that we conduct in January. We invite people from all over India in that program. It's a 3-day event. Okay. Another program will come in May. So that's the summer count, when we go in the night to count the crocodiles. Okay. So let's see if the things work out properly and nicely. We may be able to conduct this summer crocodile count. So in that you can participate with us if you want to.
So means physically we can participate or?
Yes. If the COVID situation permits us, you know, till now it's not feasible or it's not advisable to get to collect people Okay, but in I mean, let's hope that the things get better in during the summer till May, so that we may be able to invite people here for the crocodile count. We will advertise the event in 2 months before, so that you can register in that event, right?
Yes, sir. Please notify through email or anything, because I want to
just participate. Keep following our social medias, Instagram, YouTube and Twitter, even our Facebook page also, so that you get the updates from our organization, right?
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir, so much.
Okay, Rashmi. Thank you so much for talking. Okay. Nice talking to you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. I think in chats we'll share our links, different links, our emails and our website. So anybody who wants to use that, just go to that chat box, chat section, and you will have the information. Okay, Rashmi, thank you so much. I think we'll take one more question if anyone want to ask. No one? Anyways, if you have more questions, then you can just email your questions to me on my email. Okay. Anirudh@vncindia.org. anirudh@vncindia.org. That's my email. So if you have a query, you can just email me your queries and we'll respond to it. Okay, thank you everyone. Thanks you everyone once again for joining me and bearing me for such a long time. Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, so much.
Thank you.